Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy for the date 11th of July 2019. Displayed are the list of news articles taken up for today's analysis, along with the page numbers of Chennai, Bengaluru, Delhi and Thiruvananthapuram editions. The handwritten notes in PDF format and the timestamping of all the news articles taken up for today's analysis will be available in the description section and also in the comment section for the benefit of the smartphone users. Let us now move on to our discussion. Let us see an editorial which is about India's population and its associated issues. The analysis of this editorial will be helpful in your prelims preparation under economic and social development, particularly under demographics. The analysis will also be relevant in your mains preparation in General Studies Paper 1 under Population and Associated Issues. Now, the author starts the editorial with the World Population Prospects Report that was released last month. From prelims point of view, let us see about this report now. The World Population Prospects 2019 is published by the Population Division of the UN Department of Economic and Social Affairs. This United Nations Department of Economic and Social Affairs is a part of United Nations Secretariat. If you see, this report provides a detailed overview of global demographic patterns, that is nothing but the population patterns, and about the prospects of having such a population. So here prospects means the possibility or likelihood of occurring of some future event. The author tells that as per this report, India will overtake China as the most populous country by the year 2027. Now, the author is surprised over the coverage of this news in the media in India. She thinks that it is not a news that deserves media coverage. It is a known fact that India certainly will become the most populous country in the world. Usually, if you see, the population projections are developed using existing population. So, the expected births, expected deaths and the expected migration that is likely to happen in the future is calculated using the existing population as the base value. The author tells that for short-term projections of population, the biggest impact comes from an existing population who are the women in childbearing ages. To prove this fact, the author has given an example. The author has compared the section of population, that is the population of women in childbearing ages, especially in the age group between 15 and 39 years between India and China. For this year, that is for 2019, China is estimated to have 235 million of this section of population, that is 23.5 crores. Whereas for India, it is estimated to be 253 million, that is 25.3 crores. So, we can see that China is able to have a considerably lesser estimate when compared to India. The author tells that China's one-child policy is the reason. If you see, China came up with this one-child policy in the year 1979. The aim of that particular policy was to reduce the fertility rate, that is the birth-giving rate. And it has worked for China now. So, we can see that India's population is likely to grow faster than China in the future. And soon India will overtake China as the most populous country. But we do not know in which year India will actually overtake China as the most populous country. So the author tells that it remains a surprise. She tells that the United Nations revises its population projections every 2 years. If you see in the year 2015, it was predicted that India would overtake China as the most populous country in 2022. But in the 2019 projections, that is the recent projections which were released last month, the United Nations has predicted that India would overtake China as the most populous country in the year 2027. Also, the United Nations in its report has revised India's expected population size in the year 2050. If you see in the 2015 report, it was 1,705 million, that is 170.5 crores. But in the recently released report, it is mentioned as 1,639 million, which is 163.9 crores. The main reason for both these is that India's fertility rate has started to decline slowly. So it has started to reduce. The author tells this as a good sign. Though the population is likely to reduce, India will still be the most populous country throughout most of the 21st century, that is still 2100. We are now in 2019, so it is still 80 more years to go, and till 2100, India will be the most populous country in the world. The author has stressed that India needs to focus on three critical issues so that this growing population of India can be used in a very productive way for India's welfare. So India's growth in the future is based on how India deals with these three critical issues. The first issue that the author discusses is the population control. Now, there are sharp differences between how India and China has handled the population control measures in all these years. If you see, China is a strong communist power. The one-child policy of China worked out very well since China enforced it on its citizens very strictly. Whereas it is not possible for a country like India, since India is a democracy. And India cannot enforce such control measures very stringently because there will be backlash from several sections of the society. So for democracies like India, they have to go for soft measures. And the author tells that India has tried with all the soft measures that it could use, like the restriction of maternity leave and other maternity benefits for first two births only. Then in some states, there is a rule that people with more than two children would face disqualification from the panchayat elections, nothing but the local body elections. Then like giving minor incentives for sterilization. If you see with regards to the maternal benefits, the Maternal Benefit Act of 1961 was amended in the year 2017. Where the maternal benefit or a leave period was increased from 12 weeks to 26 weeks for women with two surviving children, but it was just 12 weeks in case of women with more than two children. So if they have more than two children, their leave will be only 12 weeks. So these are some of the soft measures that has been taken by a democracy like India. If you see in our 2019 prelims also, we had a question on this Maternity Benefit Act. The author tells that giving such incentives, that is some monetary benefits and other benefits for undergoing sterilization, is a very powerful way to control the population growth. But even such soft measures cannot be enforced, but it should be encouraged among the population. So there is a sharp difference between enforcing and encouraging. For example, we just saw that some states like Madhya Pradesh, as mentioned by the author in this editorial, has a rule that people with more than two children would face disqualification from panchayat elections. This is an example of enforcement. Not everyone will try to follow this rule of the government. If they feel that children are important to them, then they would just not follow this rule. So this type of enforcement, even though it is a soft measure by the government, is not going to work. Instead, what would work is encouraging people to have smaller families voluntarily. So the second issue where the government needs to focus is to encourage people to have smaller families voluntarily. Again, this depends on the socioeconomic factors in the society, that is the poor-rich divide. The author tells that there are huge differences in fertility among different socioeconomic groups. Here, the author has mentioned the term total fertility rate. The total fertility rate refers to the total number of children born or likely to be born to a woman of childbearing age in her lifetime. The author tells that in the year 2015-16, the total fertility rate for the poorest women was 3.2, whereas it was just only 1.5 for the richest quintile. Here, quintile means 5 equal portions. So to get the total fertility rate of 1.5, more percentage of the population among this top 40% must stop at one child. So that is the total fertility rate of 1.5 is achieved. Now, there is a difference in how India and the Western nations think about having just one child or having a low fertility rate. If you see in the Western nations, the developed nations, usually there is a conflict between work and bringing up a child. So the desire for having a child is very less in the Western countries. Whereas Indians like to have a child always, since most of the women do not go to work in India. So why Indians also think that they should have just one child? The author tells that Indians wish to provide a good education to their children so that they can get good jobs in the future. So both these are the factors that push Indians to limit to having just one children. Now, for the richer population, it is very easy to get good colleges and good jobs. But it is not easy for the poor population to get good colleges or good jobs. So if the government focuses on providing quality education and good jobs to all, then even the poor households might think to have only few children. The author also adds that safe contraceptive services, that is birth control services, should be easily available to this section of population so that the total fertility rate can be controlled. Now coming to the third issue. The third issue which the author has discussed is regarding the development policies that are framed by India, which are associated with population. The author tells that certain methods are outdated or they are not suitable in the current scenario. So the author tells that India must change its mindset about how population is incorporated in broader development policies. Here, first the author has discussed the seat allocation in Lok Sabha and the center state financial allocation under various finance commissions. Now, the regular practice is that all the policy decisions like these two are based on the 1971 population of the states of India. But between the year 1971 and now, the population growth is different in different states. So each state has different population growth rate. If you see, the population of Kerala grew by 56% between 1971 and 2011 census, whereas during the same time period, that is between these 40 years, the population of Bihar, Uttar Pradesh and Madhya Pradesh grew by 140%. Now, the author tells that the 15th Finance Commission is expected to use the 2011 census for giving its recommendation. So what is the confusion here? If Kerala's population growth is just 56%, then it means that Kerala has worked towards reducing its total fertility rate through various interventions, which means it has controlled its population growth rate over these 40 years. At the same time, if the population of states like Bihar, Uttar Pradesh and Madhya Pradesh has grown by 140%, then it means that the respective state governments have not focused towards controlling their population or reducing their total fertility rates. Now, if the 15th Finance Commission is going to allocate funds to the states based on 2011 census, then the funds would naturally be more for the states such as Bihar, Uttar Pradesh and Madhya Pradesh, which has a higher population now. So the southern states like Kerala would receive less funds. The author tells that this is like giving a punishment to those states which have worked hard to reduce their population growth rates. So the author tells that the move to use the 2011 census for funds allocation by the Finance Commission will favor the north central states of India like Bihar, Uttar Pradesh and Madhya Pradesh when compared to the southern states like Kerala and Tamil Nadu. But the author is supporting this change in the calculation methodology, if you see, based on the concept of demographic dividend. If you see, the tax money is collected by the states on behalf of the central government. Then the states transfer the money to the center and the center again redistributes the tax to all the states based on various parameters. So the census-based allocation or the population-based allocation is one such parameter. Here, the author has insisted that the government should go ahead with the 2011 census-based allocation based on the concept of demographic dividend. Now, what is this demographic dividend? The demographic dividend means the growth in an economy that is the result of a change in the age structure of a country's population. Now, India will keep growing in terms of population, but the population growth among the various states is largely varying. To understand this, let us see the five stages of demographic transition with the help of this picture to know what is meant by demographic dividend. Now, if you see, India is in stage 2. It is mentioned here, Egypt, Kenya and India. So, the country's population is increasing and the birth rate is more or less remaining the same. And the death rate is decreasing. This means that the birth of new kids is happening constantly. At the same time, the death rate is also decreasing. So the overall population will be increasing only. Now let us compare the stages with different states of India. If you see, states like Kerala and Tamil Nadu are in the stage 4, where the population is becoming stagnant with lower birth rates and also lower death rates. But states like Haryana and Uttar Pradesh are in the stage 2, similar to what India was. So we can see that in some states, the demographic transition has just started, what we call the onset. And in some other states, the demographic transition is going to end or it is going to get saturated. Now, the author tells that whenever the working age population is high in a particular state, then the child dependency ratio is falling because they start to become adults. The children start to become adults and also the old age dependency ratio is also still low. But this opportunity only lasts for 20 to 30 years as per the author. She tells that for states such as Kerala and Tamil Nadu, which has experienced decline in the total fertility rates, they have crossed the stage of having a high working age population. So they have lost the demographic window of opportunity. So our title is demographic window of opportunity. That is the opportunity based on the population. Now remember this term, demographic window of opportunity. The author has referred to the United Nations Population Fund estimates. Now, according to this estimates, at present, Kerala's working age population is supporting states like Bihar and Uttar Pradesh. Over the next 20 years, this demographic window of opportunity will be open for states such as Karnataka, Haryana, and Jammu and Kashmir. Now, as this demographic window of opportunity closes for these states, then it will open for states such as Uttar Pradesh, Bihar, and other states that are the last to enter the fertility transition. That is nothing but the stage 2 in this picture. This suggests that workers of Bihar will be supporting the aging population of Kerala in 20 years. So you can see that within 20 years, the cycle will reverse. Where Kerala was once supporting Bihar and Uttar Pradesh, after 20 years, Bihar and Uttar Pradesh will start to support Kerala. Now, because the working age population in states like Bihar would become more, then they would start collecting more taxes, whereas Kerala will be collecting less taxes. So the cross subsidies will now flow in the opposite direction from Haryana to Kerala. So we just saw that the taxes would be transferred from the states to center and again reallocated from the center to states. This is called as the concept of cross subsidies. And these cross subsidies will now flow in the opposite direction from Haryana to Kerala. This is the main reason why the author is supporting the 2011 census based allocation by the Finance Commission, so that there will be a balance. She tells that the developed states like Kerala and Tamil Nadu, which are arguing that 2011 census based allocation is an injustice, will have to worry in the future because they'll not be able to contribute more in the future. Finally, the author has given some suggestions where the government must focus to improve this demographic dividend. We have seen that states like Uttar Pradesh and Bihar as a demographic window of opportunity in the next 10 years or so. So their productivity has to be enhanced or increased in the future. So the author tells that the government must invest on the education and health of the future workforce of these states. And the author tells that it is time for India to accept the fact that it will become the most populous nation in the future. So India must work towards enhancing, that is improving the lives of its present citizens and also its future citizens. With this, we come to the end of the analysis of this editorial. Now have a look at the practice question. Let us move on to the next news article. Now this news article is about Pradhan Mantri Matru Vandana Yojana. The analysis of this news article will be relevant in your prelims preparation under current events of national importance and next under social development, particularly under social sector initiatives. The analysis will also be relevant in your mains preparation in your general studies paper 1 under role of women, poverty and developmental issues. Now, this news article has appeared in Thiruvananthapuram edition only. Therefore, for the benefit of viewers and the subscribers from other locations, the link for the news article from the Thiruvananthapuram edition has been given in this description. The analysis will also be relevant under welfare schemes for vulnerable sections of the population by the center and states and the performance of these schemes, and also under issues relating to development and management of social sector services relating to health in your general studies paper 2. Now let us see the news article. The news article states that the state of Kerala stands at 11th position in fund utilization under the maternal benefits program, which is called Pradhan Mantri Matru Vandana Yojana. So remember, Matru means a term which is related to mother in Hindi. Vandana in Hindi means to treat with respect. So this scheme is related to treating women with respect during the period of pregnancy and also after giving birth, that is during the period of lactation, by giving them monetary benefits. And Pradhan Mantri means Prime Minister. So the targeted beneficiaries under this program are all eligible pregnant women and lactating mothers who add their pregnancy on or after 1st of January 2017 for their first child. Therefore, the news article states that the program is being implemented since the year 2017. Note that the total number of beneficiaries across the country under this program is around 87 lakhs as of now. We saw that the monetary benefits are being given to women. Here, the monetary benefit or the cash incentive is given in 3 installments, which are rupees 1000, rupees 2000 and again rupees 2000 respectively. To be eligible to get this first installment of 1000 rupees, the women must register within 150 days of the last menstrual period, that is within 150 days of pregnancy. The beneficiary should have had at least one antenatal checkup for availing the second installment of Rs. 2000, and it can be claimed after 6 months of pregnancy. Here, the term antenatal means before birth, that is during or relating to pregnancy. Next, the third installment. The third installment of Rs. 2000 can be received after childbirth registration and the completion of the first cycle of vaccinations. See, the incentive is provided directly into the bank account of the beneficiaries. Those pregnant women and lactating mothers who are in regular employment with the central or the state governments or in some other public sector units, or those who are receiving similar benefits under any law, are not eligible for benefits under this particular scheme. All other pregnant and lactating mothers are eligible under this scheme. It is found that due to economic and social conditions, many women continue to work to earn for their family even up to the last days of their pregnancy. And because of such socio-economic conditions, they resume work soon after giving childbirth, even though their bodies may not permit it. That is, their physical health may not permit it. This therefore affects their health and the nutrition of their babies as well. For such mothers, it is not feasible to exclusively breastfeed their young infant in the first 6 months. Therefore, the scheme helps the pregnant and the lactating mothers, particularly those who are in such economic or social distress. The major objectives of this program include providing partial compensation for the wage loss through cash incentives in three installments, which we saw. Now, this compensation is given so that the pregnant and the lactating mother can take required and enough rest before the delivery of the first living child and also after the delivery of the first living child. In case of miscarriage or if there is a stillbirth, the beneficiary can claim the remaining installment in future pregnancy. Here, a miscarriage means it is a death of the fetus during pregnancy, and stillbirth means it is a death of a baby before or during delivery. So, a child dies either before or during the delivery. The idea behind the cash incentive is that it would lead to improved health-seeking behavior among the pregnant women and lactating mothers. Know that this Pradhan Mantri Matru Vandana Yojana is a centrally sponsored scheme. So, if it is a centrally sponsored scheme, the center and the states would share for that particular project. So, here the cost sharing ratio between the center and the states and also the center and the union territories with legislature is 60:40. And for northeastern states and Himalayan states, it will be 90:10. So, 90 will be sponsored by the center and 10 by the states. And for union territories without legislature, absolute or 100% funding is being done by the central government. So, here the union territories with legislature are only the union territories of Delhi and Puducherry. Now, the scheme is implemented by the state governments or union territories through their Women and Child Development Department or the Social Welfare Department or through the state's Health and Family Welfare Department. The implementation process uses the platform of Anganwadi Services Scheme of the Integrated Child Development Scheme, which is an umbrella scheme for the entire child development in India. Now, know that this Integrated Child Development Scheme comes under the Ministry of Women and Child Development. With this, we come to the end of this article discussion. Now, have a look at the practice question. Let us move on to the next news article. This news article is about the Shigella infection. The analysis of this news article will be relevant in your prelims preparation under current events of national importance and also under general science. Now, this Shigella infection is also called as Shigellosis. It is caused by a foodborne pathogenic bacteria called Shigella. Here, a foodborne means the bacteria that enters the human body through the food which we eat. So, Shigella is a genus name. There are four types of Shigella found, which are Shigella dysenteriae, next Shigella flexneri, next Shigella sonnei, and next Shigella boidii. Now, just hear the names once, you need not memorize them. This Shigella infection is one of the major causes of diarrhea in India. Apart from diarrhea which it causes, it also causes abdominal pains or cramps and also fever. Here, cramps means painful involuntary contraction of a muscle or muscles during pain. So, you feel like somebody is pulling your stomach inside. The symptoms usually last for 5 to 7 days, but some people may experience symptoms anywhere from a few days to 4 or more weeks. Some rare conditions happen because of this Shigella infection. Some of them are mentioned in this picture, like it causes dehydration. So the most common cause is dehydration, which is nothing but the loss of water in the body. Next, it can also cause seizures, nothing but fits or convulsions. Then it causes rectal prolapse. In this picture, if you see, this portion is called as rectum. If it comes out of the anus, then it is called as rectal prolapse. And Shigella infection also causes reactive arthritis. So arthritis means joint pain and swelling. So just try to know these names. These are not required from exam point of view. Just try to know the common symptoms. We saw that Shigella is caused by a bacterium. So in severe cases of Shigella infection, certain antibiotic medicines such as ciprofloxacin and azithromycin are given to cure the infection. Now, most people will recover from shigellosis without treatment within 5 to 7 days. And people who have shigellosis should drink plenty of fluids to prevent dehydration. And mainly, if you see, Shigella spread through stools only, nothing but the human fecus. So the affected individuals should wash the hands properly and also in frequent intervals to avoid any further infection because of this Shigella bacterium. Then individuals affected with Shigella infection should not consume water from ponds, lakes, or even from swimming pools accidentally. And they should not prepare food for others if they're suffering from diarrhea because of this infection. Now, a person can also be affected with Shigella infection if he has had exposure to stools during sexual contact with someone who is sick or who has recently recovered from Shigella infection. Now, let us see the news article. The news tells that two incidents of Shigella infection or shigellosis were reported in two different districts of Kerala in the last 2 weeks. The first district is the district of Calicut or Kozhikode, which is located in the northern part of Kerala. And the second district is the district of Alappi or Alappuzha, which is located in the central part of Kerala. Kerala is known for its rich green environment, and now with the starting of the monsoon, more waterborne and foodborne infections will be on the rise. If you see, last month also we saw some infections like a Nipah fever and many other fevers. Now, the school students from both these districts have been affected because of this Shigella infection. They complained of vomiting and diarrhea, and many became ill. When the affected children were tested, especially their stools, when they were tested, it was found that Shigella bacteria was found in their stool samples. And they found that water source, which was used for cooking the lunch, had been contaminated with the Shigella bacteria. And when the food samples went to microbiological and chemical testing, it was also found that E. coli bacteria, then coliform bacteria, and mold fungus were also present in these food samples. So all these are pathogenic bacteria or disease-causing bacteria that affects the humans. Now have a look at the practice question. Let us move on to the next news article. This news article is about the ASR-AAM missile for Indian Air Force fighter fleet. Now the analysis of this news article will be relevant in your prelims preparation under current events of national and international importance. Then in your mains preparation in your general studies paper 2, under agreements involving India and or affecting India's interests. Then it can also be linked to your General Studies Paper 3 under the area security. Now, the Indian Air Force is looking to adopt a missile which is developed by a European company. And this European company is the MBDA Missile Systems. The missile is named as ASRAAM. The full form of this ASRAAM is Advanced Short Range Air-to-Air Missile. So this missile is an air-to-air missile. When we say air-to-air missile, it means when the fighter jet is flying in the air, it can shoot the missile in mid-air to hit another object which is flying in the mid-air. The news article states that the missile has already been approved for Indian Jaguar fighter jets. And the integration of this ASRAAM missile with the Jaguar jets is currently going on. The news article states that the MBDA missile systems is working with Hindustan Aeronautics Limited about the integration of the missile in other fighter jets in Indian fleet. Therefore, the news article says that Indian Air Force is looking to integrate the missile with Sukhoi 30 MKI fighter jets and Indigenous light combat aircraft. Now, let us see about this MBDA missile systems. This particular company, European company, was created in December 2001, after the merger of the main missile systems companies in France, Italy, and the United Kingdom. Next, about the Hindustan Aeronautics Limited. It is a government-owned defense manufacturing company in India. Now, this ASRAM is an advanced short-range missile having a range of just over 25 kilometers. It is also a within visual range missile. When we say within visual range missile, this missile will be helpful in an air-to-air combat where both the combatants or the fighters can see each other and can shoot the missile. Such kind of within visual range fight is also called as dogfight in aerial combat. So the term is dogfight. So this ASRAAM therefore is also called as close combat missile. There is another category which is called as beyond visual range missiles. Here the combatants will not be visually seeing each other. So the fighters who are in that fighter jets will not be visually seeing each other. In such instances, beyond visual range missile can be guided by radar to hit the approaching enemy object even far to the tune of more than 70 kilometers. But we saw that this ASRAAM missile is a within visual range missile. So just know the difference. One another special information with respect to this ASRAAM missile is that after integration, it will be the first missile in Indian Air Force that will be launched over the wing of an aircraft. If you see, all the missiles of Indian Air Force are now fired from under the wing. So the missile will be placed as it is placed in the picture here over the wing of the aircraft. Now have a look at the practice question. Let us move on to the next news article. This news article is about one of the four proposed codes. These codes are aimed at merging 44 central labor laws. Now, the analysis of this news article will be relevant in your prelims preparation under current events of national importance and next under Indian polity and governance. The analysis will also be helpful in your mains preparation in your general studies paper 2 under government policies and interventions for development in various sectors. Then it can also be linked to your general studies paper 3 under issues relating to employment. Now, this news article is about the Code on Occupational Safety, Health and Working Conditions Bill 2019. This code is said to have an impact on 40 crore unorganized workers. The news article mentions that this code will apply to all trades, including IT establishments and service sectors where there are at least 10 or more than 10 workers. But in case of mines and docks, if you see, the code will be applicable even if there is only one worker working there. Here, just know that docks means an enclosed area of water in a seaport, which is used for the loading purposes, then unloading purposes, and also where the repair of the ships are carried out. Then it is said that this code has been drafted after the amalgamation, that is joining, then simplification and rationalization of the provisions of the 13 central labor laws. Then one of the most important provision for workers in this bill is that any business entity with 10 or more workers are mandatorily required to issue appointment letters to those workers. And also there must be an annual medical health checkup for all its workers. Then the bill aims to enrich and enhance the provisions related to safety, health and working conditions compared to the present scenario of the workers. Then the bill also has provisions for setting up of facilities such as creche, canteen, first aid and a welfare officer. Here, just know that creche means a nursery where babies and young children are cared for during the working day. So when the mothers or parents are working, they can just leave their baby in the creche so that the babies will be taken care in that particular setup. Then the bill talks about business entities permitting women to work beyond 7 p.m. and before 6 a.m. But this is subject to safety, consent, holidays, working hours or any condition prescribed by the government with respect to the business entities. Women employees can be allocated or allotted night shifts only after taking their consent for night work. This provision is important because it has been widely reported that women are influenced and made to work in night shift in business entities without the consent and without adequate safety and security measures. There are few of the provisions of the bill that has just caught the approval of the cabinet. If you see, the bill has to be passed by both the houses and also should get the assent of the President of India in order to become an enforceable legislation. Now, this bill is part of the proposal to merge all the 44 central laws which are related to labor and employment into just four codes. Now, we have just seen one code which is on occupational safety, health and working conditions of the laborers. The other codes are the code on wages, next the code on social security, and next the code on industrial relations. Let us move on to the practice questions discussion session. The first question is about Pradhan Mantri Matru Vandana Yojana. Now they have given two statements and they have asked you to choose the correct answer. Let's see the first statement. The first statement tells that the scheme aims to provide cash incentives to pregnant women and lactating mothers for wage loss so that they can take adequate rest before and after the delivery of first living child. So this part of the statement is correct. The next part is the scheme is a central sector scheme. Now we saw during our discussion that it is a centrally sponsored scheme. It is not a central sector scheme. So the first statement is wrong here. So the cost sharing ratio between the center and the states and the center and the union territories with legislature, that is for the union territories of Delhi and Puducherry, is 60:40. Then we saw that for union territories without legislature, 100% funding is being supported by the central government. And for the northeastern states and the Himalayan states, the cost sharing ratio between the center and the states is 90:10. Moving on to the second statement. The second statement is the implementation process of the scheme uses Anganwadi Services Scheme of Integrated Child Development Services Scheme. Now, this is a correct statement. This particular integrated child development scheme program was launched on the birthday of Mahatma Gandhi in the year 1975. The program is for the early childhood care and development. So the beneficiaries under this scheme are children with the age group of 0 to 6 years, then pregnant women and also the lactating mothers. So here the first statement is wrong and the second statement is correct. And the question is asked for the correct statement. So the correct answer is option B, 2-1B. Moving on to the second question. This question is regarding the Shigella infection and they have given two statements and have asked you to choose the correct statement. Here the first statement is Shigella infection is caused by a bacterium and it is one of the leading causes of diarrhea in India. Now this statement is correct. We saw during our discussion it is caused by a bacterium and there are four species under this genus of Shigella and it is one of the leading causes of diarrhea in India. Now let us see the second statement. The second statement tells that blood transfusion is the leading cause of Shigella infection. This statement is wrong. We saw that the leading cause of Shigella infection is through the stools or the human fecus. So the affected individuals were told to wash their hands properly and also in frequent intervals to avoid any further infection. Then the individuals who are affected with the Shigella infection should not consume water from ponds, lakes or even from the swimming pools for entertainment purposes. And they should not also prepare food for others if they are suffering from diarrhea because of this Shigella infection. Then we also saw a point that a person can also be affected with Shigella infection if he has had exposure to stool during sexual contact with someone who is sick or who has recently recovered from Shigella infection. So here the second statement is wrong and the first statement is correct and the question is asked for the correct statement. So the correct answer is option A, 1-1B. Moving on to the third question, what is ASRAAM sometimes seen in the news? Here the correct answer is option B, which is an advanced air-to-air close combat missile. We saw that it is not an indigenous missile. Indigenous in a context means the missile must have been developed in our country using homegrown technology. That is our own technology. We have seen that it is not a missile which is developed by India. It was developed by a European company called as MBDA Missile Systems. Now the full form of this ASRAAM is Advanced Short Range Air-to-Air Missile. And its range is just over 25 kilometers, which is a within visual range missile. That is, the missile can be operated in a close combat only, where the combatants or the fighters can see each other. So the correct answer to this question is option B, an advanced air-to-air close combat missile. Moving on to the mains question. The question is, India will become the world's most populous nation by the year 2027, according to the World Population Prospects Report of 2019. In the backdrop of the above statement, discuss the associated issues and measures to be taken in order to realize the potential of demographic dividend. Now, the first statement is a fact which is said by UN in its report, World Population Prospects Report 2019. So, just draw a small graph showing India's present population, its projected population in the year 2027 and also in the year 2050. Now, the second part is the actual question. It has asked you to discuss the associated issues. So, mention the issues in managing such a huge population socially, economically and also politically. Then you can even mention how overpopulation affects the environment. So try to give your answer in various dimensions. Next, the question has asked you to list out the measures to be taken in order to realize the potential of demographic dividend. So explain the concept of demographic dividend. We saw during our editorial analysis that demographic dividend means the growth in an economy that is the result of a change in the age structure of a country's population. So as a population age structure changes, the growth also varies or changes accordingly. We discussed some of the measures during our editorial analysis, like providing good education and proper healthcare facilities, then providing more cross subsidies to the overpopulated states, which the 15th Finance Commission has proposed as per the 2011 census data methodology calculation, etc. So you can also mention some more measures based on the issues that you have mentioned in your answer, and try to give one or more important statistics when you are discussing the problems. So it will be a value addition. With this, we come to the end of the analysis of all the news articles taken up for today's discussion and also the practice question discussion session. Do like, comment and share the video, and do subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for latest videos and updates. Stay focused and motivated, friends. Thank you.